Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is lecture number 10. The name of the paper is Criticism 1. We have been studying Aristotle's Poetics. And in the Poetics, today the topic will be Aristotle's Theory of Tragedy, or you can say Parts of Tragedy. We will cover these items in this lecture. The whole lecture about Aristotle's Theory of Tragedy might take 3 or 4 lectures, but in today's lecture we will cover these points. First of all, we will have the definition of tragedy. We will define it, and we will discuss the items in it, the different parts it has. We will discuss the three objects of imitation, which are capsulized in the definition of tragedy, the two means of imitation, one manner of imitation. We will also discuss what is meant by serious, magnitude, and completeness. This lecture is specifically for the students of BS English 5th semester UDC Babi, and it is also for the students of those colleges which are affiliated with Abdul Wali Khan University. The topic is, as I said, Aristotle's Theory of Tragedy, or Parts of Tragedy. In this is the definition of tragedy, Aristotle has capsulized the whole of the discussion which follows in the book, and mostly Poetics is about tragedy. Something which is complete in it is the discussion of tragedy. This definition, which we will take here, has different words, different items to be explained. For example, it talks about the objects of imitation, about the means of imitation. The objects of imitation are three, the means of imitation are two, and there is one manner of imitation. These will be discussed. Then in the definition also, he talks about seriousness. Why is this important? We'll discuss it. And he also tells us about the completeness of action. He tells us that the action should have magnitude, and the function of tragedy is also told about, and how does this tragedy arouse pity and fear, and what is meant by catharsis, and what is meant by hamartia. So these are the things which we will discuss here. They will come in the definition of tragedy. You have to memorize the definition of tragedy. And of course, you have to understand it as well. Aristotle defines tragedy by calling it as imitation. He says tragedy is the imitation of an action. Now, you see, imitation is the major genre. I mean, art is the major genre in which tragedy is included. And all art is mimesis or imitation. And Aristotle took this word imitation or mimesis from Plato, as we have already discussed this. And as this, every art is imitation, so he has to differentiate tragedy from the other types of arts. And as a result, he talks about the imitation, the means of imitation, the objects of imitation, and the manner of imitation, so that it could be differentiated from the other arts. Therefore, he says tragedy is the imitation of an action. Action, which we will later on discuss as plot. By action, he actually means plot. This is the imitation of an action, this tragedy that is serious. When he says serious, he is excluding comedy. Comedy is also a drama, but when he says the action is serious, he means to say that it would not be comedy. So comedy is excluded. Then he says that this action should be complete. And we will discuss this completeness. That completeness means that it has proportionality, that it has a proper beginning, middle, and a proper end. This is what he means by completeness. By completeness and magnitude as well. And magnitude, by magnitude, and he says it has certain magnitude, and by magnitude he means to say that it should have, it should not be too long, neither should it be too short. If it is too long, you cannot see it as a whole. If it is too short, then you cannot appreciate the parts. So this is, we'll discuss it in detail, all these points. What is meant by action, what is meant by serious, what is meant by complete, and what is meant by magnitude. As I said, tragedy is encapsulized form, the whole of the book. The poetics is actually the definition of tragedy. Everything is in it. And the expansion of this definition is that book. So if we repeat it, tragedy is the imitation of an action that is serious. This action is serious. This action is complete. And this action is of a certain magnitude. We will take these points, these highlighted points, once again. Then he tells us that this tragedy is written in language embellished. Embellished means decorated with each kind of artistic ornament. What is that artistic ornament in which this language of tragedy is ornamented or embellished? We will discuss the type of meter used here, the singing process, the chorus used to sing, and that singing will also be the artistic ornament. We will discuss what is that embellishment of the language. How is this language embellished or made beautiful? The several kinds of embellishment or these ornaments being found in separate parts of the play. There are different parts of the play, and in different parts of the play you can find out the artistic ornament of that language. That language is beautiful language, and how is it made beautiful? What is that artistic ornament? We will discuss it. Meter is one of it. In the form of action, not of narrative. When he says action, he is excluding epic writing or epic or narration. When you exclude narrative, it becomes a dialogue and it becomes action, or it becomes a drama. But the narration, when it is excluded, that epic form is also excluded. Through pity and fear, this is the function of tragedy, to arouse pity. Pity for who and fear for who? This is what we will discuss. Effecting, producing the proper catharsis of these emotions. This is another word, a very controversial word, and explained differently by different writers. And we will also explain this in detail. To repeat, these are the items found in this definition of tragedy: the objects of imitation, the means of imitation, the manner of imitation, the seriousness, completeness of action, magnitude, function, which is of course to arouse pity and fear, and then to effect the catharsis of these emotions. And there is also the explanation in the word of hematia that will also be explained. So these things were found in the definition of tragedy. First of all, Aristotle makes the broader division by calling tragedy as imitation or mimesis, which all art is. All art is imitation. So this is that broader branch in which tragedy is included. But then, in order to make it different from the other branches of art, Aristotle talks about the manner of imitation, the objects of imitation, and the means of imitation. And in this way, this art, the art of writing tragedy, becomes different from other branches. So what are those three objects of imitation? This is what we are going to discuss now. The first object of imitation is character. The idea of character, the Greek idea of character, as we have already discussed in the previous lectures, is the permanent disposition of the mind of man. This is the temperament of the person, and this temperament is there in the person permanently. It is not for some time, or it is not temporary, it is permanent. So this permanent disposition of the mind of man is his character. This is also called his temperament or his mood or his inclination or his tendency to act in a particular way. Permanent means that the man of good character would always behave in the same way in all conditions. If a good man behaves in one way, for example, in dealing with a rich person, he behaves in one way, and in dealing with a poor person, he behaves in another way, then this would not be a consistent or permanent disposition of the character, and we will say that that man is characterless. So character is the permanent disposition of the mind of man. It is permanently there in the mind of person, and a good character would always behave in the same manner in all conditions, and he is consistent. This is the first object of imitation, that character is imitated, and character means this. The second is the emotion, which is also called thought. This is the temporary disposition of the mind of man. It is not permanent, because emotionality, which is called thought also by him, is for a little time, and it changes with the passage of time. You are not always emotional in a single way. Sometimes you are happy, sometimes you are not happy, sometimes you are angry, sometimes. So you can see that this property, this quality, is not permanent. It is temporary. It is also called thought. Emotion is referred to as thought as well. This is the second object of imitation, that our emotions, our thoughts, are also imitated in tragedy. The third object of imitation is action, which we later on will discuss as plot construction. The Greek idea of action is a little different from our idea of action. We call action only those activities which we can see and which are outside. But the Aristotelian concept of action is this, that the internal thought, the internal emotion, which goes before taking action, is also included in the actions. So action means that thought, that emotion which you have inside, which causes that external action, both combined together make the action. So you can see that action would include the internal thought, maybe you can call it internal action, and the external action. First you think about something and then you do it. For example, if somebody wants to kill someone, he will make a plan in his mind first. This is also the part of the action which later on he will put into action, external action. So this plot making is internal action, while the actual action is the external action. Both combined together will make action for Aristotle. So these are the three objects of imitation. One object of imitation is character. Character is imitated. The second is emotion or the thought. They are imitated. And the third is the action. Action includes the inward action, the internal thought, and the external action. So these three are objects. The means of imitation with the help of which this imitation, this mimesis is done, the mimesis of tragedy. The first is a song or melody. That this imitation takes place with the help of song or melody. You know that in Greek dramas, chorus was the major part. In the beginning, it was the only part of the drama, because drama started with the singing of the choruses. But later on, the head of the chorus, the leader of the chorus, became a separate character. Then another character was introduced, and then yet another was introduced, and the importance of chorus decreased. But chorus, as the singing group, was always there. So this singing was done by the chorus, and the meaning of singing is quite clear. It was done by the chorus. Of course, when you sing something, you have meaning in it, and that meaning was also important. But this was the first means or the manner, the means of imitation. with the help of which imitation took place. The second is the diction, the words. Of course, when you write tragedy, of course, it is written first and then it is acted upon, it is acted. So therefore, there is always that diction, the use of words, which is important. But as in dramas, the words are arranged metrically. You know what meter is. A drama or the lines, the poetic lines, actually are the metrical arrangement of words. It is written in meter. The poetry, as you know, is written in meter. Meter is made by the stresses and the unstresses. The accented and the unaccented syllable make meters. You have studied different types of meters. You have studied five types of meter in the first semester. The most important one, if you remember, was the iambus meter, which consisted of two syllables. The first syllable was unstressed and the second was stressed. While the opposite of this was trochaic meter, in which the first syllable is stressed and the second syllable is unstressed. So most of the time, the meter used in their poetry was trochaic, because it was used for singing and in dancing also. So that was it. Later on, if you study Marlowian dramas and Shakespearean dramas, you find that you have the lines which are iambic pentameter lines. So later on, iambus was used and pentameters were used, because this iambic pentameter structure was close to the spoken language. So they then used iambic pentameter. However, in the choruses, hexameter continued to be used. Hexameter nowadays not used much. It is of 6 meter line, having 12 syllables in it, and this was used. So you can see that the diction was arranged metrically. The words were arranged in meter, that is accented and unaccented syllables, and trochaic was the meter which was used in singing and dancing. And later on, iambic pentameter was used, but the chorus would use hexameter, which means that 6 meter in a line at 12 syllables. So you can see the two means of imitation. One is song or melody, and the other is diction. One is the manner of imitation, and that manner of imitation is called spectacle. Spectacle refers to the stage devices, and it is the stage direction which is important here in the spectacle, because stage direction is not the part of poetry, is not the part of the art of poetry. It is not connected with that. In spectacle, these things are included: stage devices, all those things which are used on the stage, dresses, scenery, high-heeled boots that was used in the Greek dramas, and the tragedian or the main character would often use the heel boots, big boots, so that he could be seen from far away by the people, and that he should look like a big man. Then they would also wear masks. Masks were worn for different purposes. Masks were worn because one character sometimes would perform different roles, so he would only change the mask and then come on the stage. The other use of the mask was in order to enhance the loudness of the sound. They used to use those masks so that their sound would become louder and that all the people would be able to hear that loud voice then. Spectacle is not very artistic, because it is not internal in the tragedy. It is something external, externally attached with this. Therefore, it is not highly artistic, or the effect taken from spectacle would not be that great. And the writers or the stage directors, they should not depend upon the spectacle only, because that drama would not be artistically the best drama. This part, the spectacle, which is the manner of imitation is not connected with the art of poetry. It is connected with the art of stage direction. And therefore, the effect without even the spectacle is possible with the help of these words, which are rhythmical. And you can even take the advantage of the words by describing the stage. So description of the stage is also possible in language, and that was what Shakespeare did. So without even spectacle, a drama could be a successful drama. So now you can see the items we have discussed. I told you that in the beginning we will discuss those items which are there in the tragedy. So these are the different items found in the definition of the tragedy. And then we define tragedy as the imitation of an action that is serious, complete, and of a certain magnitude. These are still to be explained. In language, embellished with each kind of artistic ornament. The artistic ornament was artistic ornament of the language was, of course, the use of meter, the use of trochaic meter, singing, dancing, singing especially. The several kinds being used is being found in separate parts of the play. Several kinds of artistic ornament in the form of action, not of narrative, through pity and fear, effecting, producing the proper catharsis of these emotions. This was the definition, extremely important from every point of view, from examination point of view as well. And then we said that the broader branch is art of the tragedy. Every art is imitation or mimesis, but then there should be differentiation from the other arts. That is done with the help of three objects of imitation: character, emotion, and action, and two means of imitation: song and diction, and one manner of imitation: spectacle. इसको उर्दू में भी सुन लें तो हम फिर आगे भी थोड़ी सी बात करेंगे. हम Aristotle's theory of tragedy or parts of tragedy पढ़ रहे हैं, और Aristotle's theory of tragedy उसकी definition में कैप्सुलाइज्ड है या समराइज्ड है, और इसमें वो हमें ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ इमिटेशन की बात करता है जो कि तीन हैं, और मीन्स ऑफ इमिटेशन की बात करता है जो कि दो हैं, और मैनर ऑफ इमिटेशन की भी बात करता है जो कि एक है. वो ये भी बताता है कि ये जो एक्शन होगा ये सीरियस होगा, और जब वो सीरियस कह दे तो कॉमेडी इससे आउट हो गई है. इसका एक्शन कंप्लीट होगा, जिसको हम पढ़ेंगे, जिसमें बिगिनिंग, मिडल और एंड हो, ये कंप्लीट कहलाता है. और इसमें मैग्नीट्यूड होगा, जिसका मतलब ये है कि ना ये ज़्यादा लंबा होगा और ना ये ज़्यादा छोटा होगा, क्योंकि अगर ये लंबा हुआ, बहुत लंबा हुआ, तो फिर आप यकमुश्त उसको देख नहीं सकेंगे, और अगर ये बहुत छोटा हुआ तो फिर आप इसके हिस्से नहीं देख सकेंगे. राइटर हम इसको डिस्कस करेंगे. फंक्शन के हवाले से इसने बात की कि ट्रेजेडी और करेगा भी मजीद, इसमें भी बात हुई, डेफिनेशन में भी बात होगी. ये पिटी और फेयर अराउज करता है. पिटी रहम और फेयर खौफ. रहम उस कैरेक्टर के लिए जिसके साथ ट्रेजेडी हुई है, और फेयर अपने लिए, क्या मेरे साथ कहीं ऐसा ना हो जाए. और इन दोनों की, पिटी और फेयर की, फिर कैथारसिस होती है, सफाई होती है. ये सफाई कैसे होती है, ये अब्दुल वहाब का एक क्वेश्चन भी है, उसको और कैथारसिस की डिस्कशन में हम करेंगे. तो कैथारसिस तब होगा, सफाई तब होगी, जब ट्रेजिक हीरो में हेमाथिया होगा. और हेमाथिया क्या होता है, ये फिलहाल हम नहीं कर रहे हैं, इस पे अलग शायद एक लेक्चर में दूं. डेफिनेशन में ये सारी चीज़ें हमने कर ली कि ये एक एक्शन को इमिटेट करता है, और इमिटेशन जो है मिमिसिस, ये तमाम आर्ट इमिटेशन है, तो फिर ट्रेजेडी भी इमिटेशन है, तो फिर ट्रेजेडी और आर्ट से कैसे मुख्तलिफ है. तो वो ऐसे मुख्तलिफ है कि नंबर वन ये सीरियस है तो ये कॉमेडी से मुख्तलिफ है, ये कंप्लीट है मुकम्मल है, मुकम्मल का मतलब ये बिगिनिंग मिडल एंड जिसमें हो, मैग्नीट्यूड ना ज्यादा लंबा हो ना ज्यादा छोटा हो, और आर्टिस्टिक ऑर्नामेंट जो लैंग्वेज की हैं उसमें मीटर आ जाएगा, उसमें सिंगिंग आ जाएगी और ट्रैकिक मीटर का इस्तेमाल आ जाएगा। ये जब वो कहता है एक्शन की शक्ल में होगा, नैरेटिव की शक्ल में नहीं होगा, तो ये डिफरेंशिएट कर रहा है एपिक से, क्योंकि एपिक में नरेशन होती है, ज़्यादातर एक्शन भी होता है लेकिन एपिक में नरेशन भी होती है, ड्रामे में नरेशन नहीं होती। और फंक्शन के हवाले से ये अराउज करता है रहम और खौफ, रहम उस शख्स के लिए जो सफ़र करता है और फेयर अपने लिए कि कहीं ये काम हमारे साथ ना हो जाए, और फिर ये जो पीटी और फेयर है इसकी सफाई होती है और ये अच्छी हालत में हो जाते हैं। कैसे हो जाते हैं इस पे हम क्लासरूम में भी बात करेंगे, मैं लेक्चर में भी बात करूंगा, लेकिन थोड़ा सा इसमें क्लासरूम में बात करने की ज़रूरत है। फिर हमने पढ़ा कि अरिस्टॉटल ने हमें ब्रॉडर ब्रांच बताया, वो तो आर्ट है, इमिटेशन है, इमिटेशन है, मेमिसिस है, ये मेमिसिस जो है या इमिटेशन जो होती है ये तो सब आर्ट में होती है, तो फिर इसमें ये क्या मुख्तलिफ है, तो डिफरेंशिएट करने के लिए वो हमें मेंशन करता है ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ इमिटेशन जो कि तीन हैं, मीन्स ऑफ इमिटेशन जो कि दो हैं, और मैनर ऑफ इमिटेशन जो कि एक है। तो हमने फिर इसके बाद डिस्कस किया कैरेक्टर को जो कि पहला ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ इमिटेशन है, हमने ये कहा कि कैरेक्टर परमानेंट डिस्पोजिशन ऑफ द माइंड ऑफ मैन है, ये मुस्तकिल तौर पर एक आदमी के आदमी में होता पाया जाता है, और एक अच्छे किरदार का मालिक ये एक ही तरह का बिहेव करेगा, ख्वा वो हर किसी के साथ हो, ये कंसिस्टेंट होगा, तो ये कैरेक्टर की इमिटेशन होती है, और ये एक ऑब्जेक्ट है जिसको इमिटेट करते हैं। इमोशन को भी इमिटेट किया जाता है जिसको थॉट वो कहता है, और इमोशन टेम्पररी डिस्पोजिशन ऑफ द माइंड ऑफ मैन है, क्योंकि ये परमानेंट नहीं होता, हर वक्त इस तरह नहीं, हर वक्त वो इमोशनल नहीं होता। इसी तरीके से एक्शन है, तो एक्शन का मतलब थोड़ा सा ये मुख्तलिफ लेते हैं, इसमें एक इंटरनल थॉट भी मुराद है जो एक्शन से पहले आता है, और फिर एक्चुअल एक्शन भी आता है, ये दोनों उसमें शामिल होते हैं, इंटरनल थॉट और एक्सटर्नल एक्शन मिलकर ये प्लाट बनाते एक्शन बनाते हैं, जिसको हम बाद में प्लाट का नाम भी देंगे। दो हमने मीन्स ऑफ इमिटेशन की बात की, एक सॉन्ग और मेलोडी म्यूजिक, सॉन्ग और मेलोडी मीनिंग क्लियर है इसकी, कोरस जो है ये सिंगिंग करती थी, जाहिर है मीनिंगफुल सिंगिंग होती है उसमें तो माना होता है, बल्कि ड्रामा का आगाज जो कि हम पढ़ेंगे इसी में पढ़ेंगे, अगर मुझे टाइम मिला इतना इम्पोर्टेंट नहीं है, लेकिन हम मैंने कसदन उसको छोड़ दिया है, मौका मिला तो पढ़ भी लेंगे, तो उसमें तो आगाज जो ड्रामे का हुआ है वो तो कोरस की सिंगिंग ही से हुआ है, कोरस का सिंगिंग ही होता था शुरू में, फिर उसके बाद लीडर के साथ कोरस का जो लीडर होता था, कोरस से मुराद तो आपको पता है कि औरतें जो के ग्रुप होता था सिंगर्स का उसको कोरस बोलते थे, और वो नगमे गाती थी, इनका एक लीडर होता था। फिर इसी से मामला ऐसे बना कि लीडर और कोरस के दरमियान सिंगिंग की शक्ल में डायलॉग्स होने लगा, ये ड्रामे का आगाज था। फिर एक एक्टर मजीद डाला गया, और आहिस्ता आहिस्ता सिंगिंग पार्ट कम अहम होता गया, फिर एक तीसरा एक्टर डाला गया तो यूं ये डेवलप हुआ ड्रामा। तो सिंगिंग तो पार्ट था ही ड्रामे का, और ये मीन्स ऑफ इमिटेशन, जरिया इमिटेशन का, ये उसमें आएगा। एक जो मीन्स ऑफ इमिटेशन है वो डिक्शन है, डिक्शन से मुराद अल्फाज का इस्तेमाल। और आपको पता है कि पोइट्री जो लिखी जाती है वो मेट्रिकल अरेंजमेंट ऑफ वर्ड्स होता है, मीटर आपने पढ़ा है, वर्ड्स को मीटर, ऐसे वर्ड्स का चुनाव किया जाता है जो मीटर बनाए। और आपको अगर याद हो तो फर्स्ट सेमेस्टर में हमने 5 मुख्तलिफ किस्म की मीटर पढ़ी थी, जिसमें से आयम बस सबसे अहम हमने पढ़ा था, जो अनस्ट्रेस्ड और स्ट्रेस्ड से मिलके बनता है, 2 सिलेबल्स उसमें होते हैं। पहला सिलेबल स्ट्रेस नहीं होता, दूसरा स्ट्रेस होता है। और इसका उलट, जिसमें पहला स्ट्रेस हो और दूसरा अनस्ट्रेस्ड हो, इसको ट्रकियक मीटर कहते हैं। तो इस ज़माने में जो मीटर इस्तेमाल होता था सिंगिंग और डांसिंग के साथ, वो ट्रकियक होता था, यानी स्ट्रेस्ड और उसके बाद अनस्ट्रेस्ड। अगर आपको याद हो, याद ना हो तो आप लेक्चर सुन लें या अपने नोट्स को चेक कर लें। बाद में तो आयम्बिक पेंटामीटर बना, ख़ास तौर पे मार्लो के ड्रामे अगर आप पढ़ें, टॉम एलन उसका ड्रामा है, और डॉक्टर फास्टस तो आपको कोर्स में भी शामिल है। तो ये आयम्बिक पेंटामीटर लाइन जो कि अनराइम्ड लाइन है उसमें लिखा गया है। और आयम्बिक पेंटामीटर जब अनराइम्ड होता है तो उसको ब्लैंक वर्स भी कहते हैं। और ये इसलिए चुना गया कि इसकी मुशाबहत स्पोकन लैंग्वेज के साथ ज़्यादा थी। कोरल पार्ट जो होता था कोरस की सिंगिंग, इसमें अक्सर ये लोग हेक्सामीटर इस्तेमाल करते थे। हेक्साम का मतलब है 6 मीटर वाला अवाली लाइन, और इसमें 12 सिलेबल होते हैं। तो ये वो हमने एम्बेलिशमेंट का भी जिक्र किया था। तो ऊपर जो ट्रेजेडी की डेफिनेशन में लैंग्वेज की एम्बेलिशमेंट है उससे ये मुराद है। एक हमने मैनर ऑफ इमिटेशन की बात की, और मैनर ऑफ इमिटेशन में हमने स्पेक्टेकल का जिक्र किया। स्पेक्टेकल से मुराद वो तमाम चीज़ें जो आपको स्टेज पर नज़र आती हैं और जिनसे ड्रामे में हेल्प लिया जाता है। मसलन अगर खून बहाना है तो ज़ाहिर है कोई रंग वगैरह केचप इस्तेमाल होगा, ये भी स्पेक्टेकल में आएगा। स्टेज में जो ड्रेसेस इस्तेमाल होंगी वो भी इसमें आएगा। सीनरी बाज़ुकात इस्तेमाल करते हैं। उस ज़माने की ट्रेजडीज़ में लंबे लंबे बूट इस्तेमाल किए जाते थे ट्रेजिक कैरेक्टर के लिए, और इसका एक मकसद ये भी होता था कि कैरेक्टर थोड़ा सा बड़ा नज़र आए। चूंकि इसको एक खुली फ़ज़ा में और एक बड़े स्टेडियम में ड्रामों को देखा जाता था, तो किरदार को बड़ा शो करना करने के लिए बड़े बड़े बूट्स और बड़े बड़े मास्क भी पहनाए जाते थे। मास्क के मुख्तलिफ रीज़न थे पहनाने के। एक रीज़न मास्क के पहनाने का ये था कि क्योंकि एक किरदार मुख्तलिफ किरदारों को अदा करता था तो वो मास्क चेंज कर देता था, तो ये दूसरा किरदार बन जाता था। और मास्क को ऐसे डिज़ाइन करते थे कि वो स्पीकर का काम देती थी और उससे आवाज़ तेज़ हो जाती थी। लेकिन अरिस्टोटल इसके फेवर में नहीं है कि इससे आप कोई ज़्यादा आर्टिस्ट्री नहीं कर सकते, क्योंकि आर्टिस्ट्री आपका प्लाट कंस्ट्रक्शन और पोइट्री में होगा। और सिर्फ इससे अगर आप खून खराबे से इफ़ेक्ट लेना चाहेंगे तो कोई अच्छा ड्रामा नहीं होगा। तो इसी वजह से ये पोइट्री के साथ कनेक्टेड नहीं है, ये स्टेज डायरेक्शन के साथ ज़्यादा कनेक्टेड है। और ऐसे प्रेजेंटेशन के बगैर भी असर लिया जा सकता है, क्योंकि जब किरदार बोलता है तो वो इस सीनरी को बयान भी कर सकता है, जैसे शेक्सपियर के बाज़ ड्रामास में इसी तरह है। मसलन शेक्सपियर समंदर को तो नहीं ला सकता स्टेज पर, लेकिन वो समंदर की बातें करके वही इफ़ेक्ट बातों से लेता है। सो दीज वर द थिंग्स विच वी डिस्कस्ड सो फार। वी आर डिस्कसिंग द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ट्रेजेडी, द थियरी ऑफ ट्रेजेडी ऑफ अरिस्टॉटल। द नेक्स्ट आइटम इज दैट द एक्शन शुड बी सीरियस। वी हैड दिस वर्ड इन द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ट्रेजेडी, that it is the imitation of an action that is serious. That word serious is here. When you say serious, you are excluding comic. That is, tragedy imitates a serious action and it is not a comic action. Therefore, comedy is excluded. It means that after telling us that tragedy is imitation, like other arts, he is now differentiating tragedy from comedy by telling us that the action is throughout serious. In Greek dramas, tragedies, it was not important that always there would be some murders, etc. But only if the action is serious throughout, then even without murders, that serious action would make a tragedy. So serious excludes comedy, and the action of the tragedy throughout is serious. This magnitude word is important because by magnitude he means to say that the action which is imitated in tragedy should neither be too long nor should it be too short. For example, in our dramas, sometimes you have so many episodes. For example, once we used to watch Anaqualagin, and Anaqualagin had multiple episodes. Sometimes you would have the episode number 531. Now, what happened in those previous 530 episodes that you could not remember? And therefore, it used to be that it was too long then. The magnitude means that there should be proportionality. It should neither be too long, because if it is too long, then you would not be able to see all the parts. You would not be able to appreciate all the parts. If it is too short, then you will not be able to see the parts. In this case, you will not be able to see all the parts at a time. When it is too short, you will see all the parts at a time, but you will not be able to appreciate all the parts. Aristotle gives the example of a very long reptile, that when you try to observe its head and start going, you reach the tail and you already have forgotten what was its head like. So this is not something proportionate. Proportionate, when you could see the whole of it in a single glance, and therefore he uses the term one revolution of the sun. The drama should not exceed one revolution of the sun, that is one day, 24 hours. So it should be proportionate, and it could have unity only when it is neither too short nor too long. Because when it is too long, you cannot see the whole of it. When it is too short, you see the whole, but you cannot see the parts. You cannot appreciate the parts. And there should be organic unity in it. Organic unity means the unity of the organ. Human body, for example, has organic unity. We are one human being, but we have a lot of parts, organs. We have hands, eyes, head, legs, etc. The whole making a single body, and that's organic unity. Nothing can be added to us, neither can anything be taken out from us. If somebody gives you an extra nose, what would you do with that nose? So therefore, there should be an organic unity. That is, neither anything could be added to the plot, neither nor something could be taken out of the plot. And we often have one action in many, because many actions are relevant and they create one punch or one action. And there are many actions in one, which again means the same thing, that many actions lead to one action, one single action towards the end. So this is what he means by the organic unity. Then he uses the word complete. And by complete, he defines complete as something which has beginning and middle and end. Beginning, now you see in real life, There is no beginning and there is no end. After every beginning, there is something which has gone before. But when he says that the action is complete in tragedy, he means to say whatever has gone before the beginning is irrelevant. That is, in the tragedy, we are not interested in what has gone before. That is, we are not concerned with that. Therefore, we have a beginning. Now, the beginning leads to the middle, but logically. It should go to the middle, but it should go logically. Middle should go to the end, but again, logically. In real life, there is no end, because after every end, there is some other beginning. But in the story or in tragedy, we should not be interested in what happened after the completion of the action. Or we should not be interested what had gone before the beginning. For example, if you take the example of Hamlet, Hamlet's father has died and his father's ghost appears and he tells Hamlet about his death, that his own brother, Hamlet's uncle, had killed him. This is now the proper beginning. This is the start. What happened before this, we are not interested in it. Something which is important to be told, that is told to us in the story later on. However, we are not interested in the beginning, what happened before this. This is a proper start. Then Hamlet wants to take action, wants to take revenge from his uncle Claudius, and he makes his plans, but he is always slow in his actions. This is his tragic flaw, and this is the middle of the action. Then he does that action of murdering or taking that revenge from Claudius, but he also loses his own life then, and he dies, and that's the proper end. So we are not interested in what happened after the death of Hamlet, neither are we interested in what happened after the beginning or the appearance of the ghost of Hamlet's father. The same thing happens in Oedipus. I have told you the story of Oedipus. Oedipus has been told by the oracles that he would marry his own mother and he would kill his own father. And from this fate, he runs away. He goes to the other country. And he runs from that fate. He tries to run. He tries hard to run from this fate. But this is the proper beginning. He runs away from there. And the middle comes when, though he was running away from the fate, he was going close to it. And he marries his own mother and kills his own father, Laius. And towards the end of the story, he is kicked out of the country, and this is the end. We are now not interested in what happened after this or what happened before this. So you can see that complete means beginning, having beginning, middle and end. What went before the beginning, that is not important. What went after the end, that is also not important. Isko Urdu mein sun le. ट्रेजिडी की डेफिनेशन में एक बात है सीरियसनेस की, कि ट्रेजिडी का एक्शन होगा सीरियस. और जब हम कहते हैं सीरियस, तो इससे नॉन सीरियस या कॉमिक एक्शन एक्सक्लूड हो जाएगा. तो यूं कॉमेडी इससे एक्सक्लूड हो जाएगी, क्योंकि वो बताना चाहता है कि ये मिमिसिस तो ये है इमिटेशन, लेकिन ये तो और आर्ट भी सारी इमिटेशन है, कॉमेडी भी इमिटेशन है. तो फिर ट्रेजिडी मुख्तलिफ क्यों है, क्योंकि ये सीरियस है. तो यूं कॉमेडी ये एक्सक्लूड हो जाएगी और ये सीरियस एक्शन की इमिटेशन हो जाएगी. मैग्नीट्यूड एक अहम टर्म है कि वो समझता है कि एक स्टोरी ना इतनी लंबी हो कि समझ पता ही ना चले सिरे और आखिर की, और ना इतनी छोटी हो कि नजर ही ना आए. वो एक रेप्टाइल की मिसाल देता है कि एक रिंगने वाला जानवर है जो मीलों लंबा है. आप उसका सर देखते हैं, फिर दुम की तरफ जाते हैं, और जब दुम तक पहुंचते हैं तो सर आप भूल जाते हैं कि वो कैसे था. तो आपको एक इफेक्ट एक नजर में मिलता नहीं है, पूरा एक नजर में दिखाई नहीं देता। इतना छोटा भी ना हो कि एक चींटी जितना हो, क्योंकि उसको तो उसके तो हिस्से नजर नहीं आते, फिर आप हिस्सों की अप्रिशिएशन नहीं कर सकते। तो लिहाजा प्रोपोर्शनलिटी होनी चाहिए, निस्बत, अच्छा तनासुब जिसको कहते हैं, ये होनी चाहिए। ना लंबा हो बहुत और ना छोटा हो बहुत। ऑर्गेनिक यूनिटी हो इसमें, जिसका मतलब ये है ऑर्गेनिक ऑर्गन से है, पार्ट्स को कहते हैं, कि सारे हिस्से यूं जुड़े हुए हो कि जिस तरह इंसानी बदन में जुड़े हुए हैं। हमारे दो हाथ हैं, दो आंखें हैं, दो कान हैं, एक नाक है, एक मुंह है, ये ऑर्गेनिक यूनिटी है। ना तो आप अपने बदन में कुछ डाल सकते हैं एक्स्ट्रा, और ना आप इससे कुछ निकाल सकते हैं। अगर आप को कोई एक नाक और दे दे कि ये भी ले लो, तो आप उस नाक की क्या करेंगे? तो उसके लगाने की कोई जगह तो हमारे पास है नहीं, तो ये नहीं हो सकता, ये ऑर्गेनिक यूनिटी है। अगर आपसे कोई नाक मांगे कि ये मुझे दे दें, तो ये भी नहीं हो सकता। तो हम कहते हैं कि ये जो मैग्नीट्यूड है, वन एक्शन इन मैनी, मैनी एक्शन इन वन, जिसका मतलब ये है कि बहुत सारे एक्शन, बहुत सारे एपिसोड्स ऐसे रिलेट होते हैं कि वो एक कंप्लीट चीज बनाते हैं, जो कि ट्रेजेडी है। कंप्लीट का हमने क्या कि कंप्लीट उसको कहते हैं, इसका बिगिनिंग हो, उससे फिर मंत्र की तौर पे मिडिल निकले और उसे एंड निकले, भाई ये मुकम्मल हो गया यहाँ से यहाँ तक। लाइफ में ऐसा नहीं होता, लाइफ में बिगिनिंग से पहले कुछ ना कुछ होता है और एंड से बाद में भी कुछ ना कुछ होता है। मसलन अगर कोई मरता है तो ये एंड नहीं है, ये उसके लिए एंड है, लेकिन ये औरों के लिए एंड नहीं है, कुछ ना कुछ मजीद होगा। लेकिन ड्रामे में ये नहीं होगा, ड्रामे में बिगिनिंग होगा, मिडल होगा और एंड होगा और बस ख़त्म। बिगिनिंग से पहले क्या था, इसमें भी हम इंटरेस्टेड नहीं है। बिगिनिंग के बाद, एंड के बाद क्या था, इसमें भी हम इंटरेस्टेड नहीं है। हमने हेमलेट और ईडिपस की एग्जाम्पल की। हेमलेट को वालिद का गोस्ट रूह बताता है कि उसके अंकल ने या उसके भाई ने और हेमलेट के अंकल ने उसको मारा है और तुम उसका बदला लो, तो ये बिगिनिंग है। अब इससे पहले क्या हुआ, हम इसमें इंटरेस्टेड नहीं है। हेमलेट फिर क्या करता है, ये फिर कोशिश करता है कि मालूम करे कि वाकई ये बात ठीक है कि ठीक नहीं है। बहुत देर लगाता है, आखिर में एक्शन कर लेता है, उसको मार लेता है, लेकिन खुद भी मर जाता है। और इसकी स्टोरी कभी सुनाऊंगा डिटेल के साथ, इतना फिलहाल काफ़ी है। ईडिपस की स्टोरी भी आपको सुना चुका हूँ, उसमें भी प्रॉपर बिगिनिंग मिडल और एंड है। बिगिनिंग से पहले क्या था, ये हमारा कंसर्न नहीं है। एंड के बाद क्या है, ये भी हमारा कंसर्न नहीं है। फंक्शन के लिए हम और भी लेक्चर करेंगे, एक लेक्चर मेरा ख्याल है कि फंक्शन के हवाले से हो जाए, तो टोटल डिस्कशन जो होगी ट्रेजेडी की, वो शायद 3 या 4 लेक्चर्स में हो जाए। तो ये पहला लेक्चर हुआ अरिस्टॉटल्स थ्योरी ऑफ ट्रेजेडी का, या पार्ट्स ऑफ ट्रेजेडी का। इसमें अहम चीज़ ये डेफिनेशन हो गई, और डेफिनेशन में सारे पार्ट्स आ गए, 3 ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ इमिटेशन और 2 मीन्स ऑफ इमिटेशन और 1 मैनर ऑफ इमिटेशन। और फिर हमने सीरियसनेस की वजाहत की, मैग्नीट्यूड की वजाहत की और कम्प्लीटनेस की वजाहत की। हम फंक्शन की बात तो कैथारसिस में डिटेल से करेंगे, लेकिन ये फंक्शन क्यों मुमकिन होता है पिटी और फियर का, इस पे हम वी विल डिस्कस इट इन द नेक्स्ट लेक्चर। थैंक यू एंड गुड लक।